أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We praise Him and we seek His help, His guidance and His forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evils of our sins and the evils of ourselves. Whomsoever Allah guides, there is no misguidance for him. And whomever He rightfully causes to lead astray, there is no guidance for him. And I bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah alone. And I bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and final messenger. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds you and I in the noble Quran, O you who have believed, be conscious of Allah as he deserves, and die not except in a state of submission to him. O you who have believed, be conscious of Allah, and let every soul reflect on what it has sent forward for tomorrow, for the day of resurrection. And be conscious of Allah, verily Allah is aware of all that you do. Imagine, if you will, someone walking up to the counter at the airport and being asked, where's your final destination? And this person responds, I don't know. Sir, where's your final destination? You need to know where you're traveling to. And this person says, I don't know. How can you possibly embark on a journey and not know your destination? Rather, as we experience throughout life, when you embark on a journey, there are many things that you have to know. You have to know your final destination. When you embark on a journey, you have to know what sustenance you need that will help you reach your destination. When you embark on a journey, you need to know what types of detours might come up in your path and how to get back on the path to your final destination. When you embark on a journey, you need to know what kinds of people might prevent you or become obstacles to your destination and what kinds of people will help facilitate your journey. When we look around us at the things that we have of this life, when you look at your health, you and I know that health is not guaranteed. It is a blessing. In one moment, it could be taken away. May Allah preserve our health. You and I know that our wealth is not guaranteed. What you have of wealth is a blessing. What you have of your career is a blessing. What you have of your family is a blessing. Of your beauty is a blessing. Of your children is a blessing. Everything, we look at this life as a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to test us. But it is never a guarantee. The only guarantee in this life is death. The only thing that humanity can agree upon, that it is inevitable, is that you and I will depart from this world at one point or another. Therefore, would it not make sense for the wise person who reflects and contemplates on the only guarantee of this world to prepare properly for it? To understand what types of sustenance will help you facilitate the good that will come after it? To understand and be tested and pass the tests of this life and the objective of this life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us for. Would it not be more rational to prepare for that which is guaranteed? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, as we just recited shortly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, and we hear frequently on Fridays, وَلْتَنْظُرْ نَفْسٌ مَّا قَدَّمَتْ لِغَدْ. Let every soul reflect on what it has sent forward for tomorrow. Some of the scholars of tafsir said that tomorrow is a mercy from Allah. Tomorrow here means the day of judgment. Why does Allah use the word tomorrow? It is out of His mercy because you and I are very forgetful. But if you thought that tomorrow, actually tomorrow, was the day of resurrection, then today would be very different. Think back to your first and most important job interview. No matter what you had going on today, you knew that tomorrow you had something important. Those who are married, think back to the day before your wedding. No matter how busy you were, you knew that tomorrow was your wedding. When you have something that is important to you, in your mind, internally, no matter how busy you are today, you fulfill the obligations of today, but you never forget that there's something very important tomorrow. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you and I to reflect and act. What have you prepared for tomorrow? You know what you've prepared for your exams in this world. You know what you've prepared for your studies and your work. You know what you've prepared of your project and so on and so forth. What have we prepared for our meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? A few years ago, I was in Ireland for a university camp or retreat for some Muslim students. And one of the organizers told me something that broke my heart. Something that made an impact on everyone there, and they never forgot it after that. They said years earlier, their camp was not a luxury camp, rather it was hiking as a survivalist type of camp in the mountains. It was about 15 university students. He said, as we were hiking in the mountains, one of the brothers, 20 or 21 years old, he slipped and he fell and something punctured his body. He started bleeding out. He said, as he's on the ground, we surrounded him to comfort him. We're putting pressure on the wound, but we have no access. None of us are physicians. We have no access to calling. We have no reception. So we didn't know what to do except to put pressure on the wound and to tell him, just in case, say la ilaha illallah. A phrase that for you and I right now is so easy. We could say it without moving our lips. So they told him, you'll be fine, you'll be okay. And just in case, just say la ilaha illallah. He couldn't respond. They said, can you hear us? He said, yes. They said, say la ilaha illallah, just in case. He couldn't respond. They asked again, can you hear us? He said, yes, I can hear you. They said, say la ilaha illallah, just in case. And he didn't respond. And finally, he opened his mouth and he said, for the last 6 months when I was alone in private, I didn't pray a single prayer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he died. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on him and use him as a lesson for others. His friends all around him started crying. Some of them openly said, we struggled fulfilling this right, the most important right in this world, the prayer. We struggled with it. But since that day, we haven't missed a single prayer on time. You will die upon what you live upon. Not publicly to the people, but between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, we will be resurrected upon what we die upon. As the Tirmidhi reported. Uthman radiallahu anhu was one time visiting the graveyard and he started crying. And his friend said to him, this was during his khilafah, his friend said to him, oh Uthman, we noticed when you hear about paradise and hellfire, you don't cry. But when you come to the graveyards or you hear or think about death, you cry until your beard is wet. Why is that the case? He said, verily I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that the grave is the first stage of the hereafter. Whoever passes through it with ease, everything after that will be easier for them. And whoever passes through it with difficulty, everything after that will be more difficult for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our moment in the grave a moment of ease. When we think about the concept of death in some societies and cultures, it is something that is gloomy. It is something that is dark and depressing. It is something that people think that if they think about it or prepare for it, it should turn them into gloomy people. But who is better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to look at as an example for humanity? When many of the companions reported that they never saw anyone smiling more than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and yet he was the most fearing of Allah. There is a balance in our faith of hope in the mercy of Allah and preparing for the mercy of Allah and fear of our shortcomings. There must always be balance. When there is imbalance, our actions will reflect that. So think, if you will, at the moment when you hear the announcement that so-and-so has passed away in the community. There's no doubt that one of these days the announcement will be for one of us. And we will think and we will say, I wish I could go back. But we do not want to be people of regrets. Because there will be many who at the moment of death, they will say, and in the year after they will say as well, يَقُولُ يَا لَيْتَنِي قَدَّمْتُ لِحَيَاتِي. I wish I prepared more or sent forward more good for my life. Referring to the eternal life as the life. We don't want to be people who at the moment of death say, oh Allah, let me go back so I can pray two more rak'ahs properly, with focus. Oh Allah, let me go back so that I can perfect my relationship with my parents, with my spouse, with my children, with my relatives, those who have a right upon me, those who I cut off. We would not be able to say, oh Allah, I wish I could go back so I can give more in charity. I wish I can go back and deal properly with good manners to my community of Muslims and non-Muslims. I wish I can go back and use the blessings that you gave me in the best way possible. Once the angel of death comes to each and every one of us, there is no going back. So we do not want to be people of regrets. And as human beings, as we know, day and night, if you don't want to regret something, then plan and prepare for it properly. It is not only an internal matter. It is not a matter of how much knowledge you have. It is a matter of implementation, action. Every single day of our lives is a reflection of what we truly want. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who act upon what we hear. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings and to grant all of us a good ending in this world. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوا إِنَّهُ وَالْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillah, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Inna allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-nabi, ya ayuhal ladhina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, ar-Rahman, ar-Rahim, al-Afu, al-Tawwab, al-Ghafur, al-Ghaffar, al-Wadud. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create us so that we would be punished. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us not just to worship Him but to get to know Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And any time we find in our lives that we are heedless or we are straying, that we are tired or we are fatigued from worshiping, that we are exhausted or that we have become lazy or that we have procrastinated, there are many internal causes, all of which can be cured by reflecting frequently on our final destinations. Again, you cannot embark on a journey and not know to where you're headed. When we recite the Quran and you study the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find many references to the hereafter. The Day of Judgment itself has over 40 different names in the Quran and Sunnah. And there was a reason for this, and it is because we are forgetful. And Allah wants to remind us, for the reminder benefits the believers. There are some people, when the reminder comes to them, whether it's on Facebook or Instagram or at a khutbah or a lecture, it will have no effect on their hearts. They do not intend at all to change. وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ. And then there are a group of people, when they hear a reminder, at that moment, they intend sincerely to make some change. And then there are some people, when they intend to change, they follow through with action. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst these people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes for us in the Quran the situation of those who are receiving their book of deeds in their right hands. And before I continue, I want to mention to you an example, an analogy of sorts. Years ago, as I was walking through university for final exams, someone opened the door to a classroom in front of me and was running down the hall towards me, someone I had never seen in my life. And this is typical of university campus. And as he's running at me, he's screaming in a loud voice or yelling in a loud voice, guess what, guess what, guess what? And I've never seen him in my life. And I turned around behind me thinking he's speaking to someone else and there was no one walking behind me. Now I'm on my way to a final exam. And as he's running at me, I'm trying to think of all the possible scenarios of what had just happened in the classroom. So when he came up to me to summarize very briefly, I said, I don't know, I have to go. He said, I passed my final exam. I passed my final exam. He ran down the hall screaming, guess what, to as many people as possible. The first thought that came to mind was the verse from Surah Al-Haqqah, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes this beautiful scenario. On a day like no other, the most important day of our existence, in which we're standing there for accountability. Everything you do builds up to that moment when you meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people who did what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded, those who fulfilled the rights of the Creator upon the creation, they receive their books in their right hands. And as soon as they do, they're so happy. They're not thinking of whom they're approaching, but they're so happy. They go around telling everyone, هَاُمْ اُقْرَأُوا كِتَابِيَا, come read my book of deeds. This is what I expected to find, because Allah fulfills His promise. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the keys to happiness, not just in this life, but in the next life as well. And it would be wise of us as human beings to take the message that the Creator has given us through the most beloved messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to learn about it as much as possible, to act upon it, to prepare for it, so that when we're standing there before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and before the rest of the creation, we're standing there happily, smiling, saying to everyone, come read my book of deeds. Because on that day you did not pass your university exam. You did not just pass a milestone in your life. You did not just secure that job or get married or have kids. On that day you're so happy that you passed the objective, the reason you were created. After which there are no more trials, no more temptations, no more hardships. There's no more pain, there's no more anxiety, there are no more tribulations. After that, a person is experiencing happiness upon happiness. Every moment better than the last. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us this description more comprehensively in our religion than any other worldview in this life. So that we are preparing for it constantly. So that we are keeping our eyes on the prize. So that when we are there on the day of judgment, we say, oh Allah, thank you for informing me and thank you for guiding me. Alhamdulillah. Praise be to Allah for the blessing of guidance. And there is no greater blessing than it. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the message of Islam that is perfect and that is correct. Because many people, when they hear about Islam, they hear about the incorrect version. They hear about a manipulation. They hear about misconceptions. So alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah who has guided us to the message of truth that is correct and proper, so that we can fulfill it and help others fulfill it as well. And you look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the entire time of prophethood was dedicated day and night, sweating, bleeding, for the sake of humanity to have this message, so that when we are standing there on the day of judgment, we are standing with no regrets. Al-Hasan al-Basri rahimahullah famously said, those who hold themselves accountable in this life frequently will find that their accountability in the next life will be easy. But those who do not hold themselves accountable frequently will find that on the day of judgment it will be more difficult. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are on a daily basis holding ourselves accountable, reflecting on our actions and our shortcomings. My dear brothers and sisters, I encourage you and I invite you to join us for a one-day seminar, a workshop tomorrow here in this masjid, about a very vivid and clear description of paradise and hellfire. And the reason I urge you for this, and I have traveled here only for this purpose, is because when you think of how many hours we spend on many other things in life, whether it's secular studies or leisure or entertainment or anything else, we spend hundreds of hours. We can surely spend a few hours studying what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told us about the hereafter. Studying how to properly implement what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed to us and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam exemplified. And it's not all information, because information is very abundant, alhamdulillah. Rather, we will work on some techniques, psychological and other, in order to implement and connect the gap that we oftentimes have, which is we have a lot of theory and knowledge, But there's a gap that we need to fulfill between that and implementation, that and action, that and execution. And remember, the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever sets upon a path to seek knowledge, Allah will make their path to paradise easy. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make our path to paradise easy. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us of those who are constantly preparing for the hereafter. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our major and minor sins. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive the believing men and women, those who are living and those who have passed away. Allahumma ighfir lil mu'minina wal mu'minat. والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات اللهم اغفر لوالدينا ولوالدي والدينا اللهم يا مقلب القلوب والأبصار ثبت قلوبنا على دينك اللهم اهدنا واهد بنا واجعلنا سببا لمن اهتدى اللهم ارزقنا الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى اللهم انصر الإسلام وعز المسلمين اللهم فرج الكرب عن المسلمين في كل مكان اللهم انصر عبادك الصالحين في كل مكان يا ذا الجلال والإكرام ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار عباد الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون فاذكروا الله العظيم يذكركم واشكروه على نعمه يزدكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقم الصلاة